Hello friends, welcome to Therm Science. In today's lecture, we will discuss fuel and combustion. It is very important to understand the basics of fuel and combustion because anything can be called as fuel when it liberates heat during combustion. Let's take an example, paper and wood. Both paper and wood can liberate heat when we burn it. But the rate of heat liberated is differs between paper and wood. Let's take an example. The paper liberates 1000 kJ of heat per kg of paper, whereas wood liberates 4500 kJ of heat per kg of wood. From this, we can conclude the rate of heat liberated is an important parameter to choose a fuel. That is known as calorific value. Now, we will discuss about fuel. Fuel is used as a source for many applications. Since it's very important of selecting a right fuel for right application. Also, we have to consider the storage, transportation, and the cost of the fuel. Fuel is a substance composed of chemical elements that is burned with oxygen to produce heat. That fuel may be solid fuel, liquid fuel, or a gaseous fuel. Now we will discuss the different types of fuel. Fuels are basically classified into two categories. One is natural fuel, the other one is artificial fuel. First one, solid fuels. It may be wood, coal, or charcoal. The major drawback of solid fuel is it has lower calorific value, that is heat liberated, and it has high ash content and moisture content. It needs maximum storage and transportation. The next fuel is liquid fuel. It has higher calorific value compared to the solid fuels and lower ash content and zero moisture we can take. The liquid fuel may be petrol, diesel, kerosene, whatever may be. The next one, gasoline fuels. It has higher calorific value compared to solid fuels and liquid fuels, and the transportation and storage also quite easier than liquid fuels and solid fuels. Example, LPG, natural gas, and methane. Now we will discuss the chemical composition of these fuels. First one, carbon. Carbon will occupy the major proportion in the chemical composition, hydrogen and sulfur. These three chemical elements only will participate in combustion. Other than these three, fuel has moisture and ash. Remember, moisture and ash will not take place in combustion, but it will absorb heat which liberated during the combustion. That's why the lower moisture, lower ash content fuels has higher calorific value, and higher moisture and ash fuels has lower calorific value. The first fuel we take, gaseous fuels. Gaseous fuels contains carbon, hydrogen and sulfur, and no moisture, no ash. That's why the calorific value of gaseous fuels will be higher than the liquid and solids. Next one, liquid fuels. Liquid fuels has carbon, hydrogen, sulfur and a small percentage of ash. That's why the liquid fuels has lower calorific value compared to the gaseous fuel, but higher calorific value compared to the solid fuels. Why? Solid fuels also contains the moisture. So this is all about fuels. Now we will discuss about combustion. What is meant by combustion? Combustion is a chemical process or reaction between fuel and oxygen. Combustion takes place only when fuel, oxidizer and igniter, three are at present at a time. If any one is not present, combustion will not take place. Which means for combustion we need igniter, oxygen and fuel. If any one is missing, the combustion is not possible. During the combustion, the large amount of heat is liberated, which means the flame or light we can call. You can see a simple chemical formula, hydrocarbons that we call hydrogen or carbon, hydrocarbon plus oxygen gives heat energy. Then what is meant by complete combustion and incomplete combustion? Complete combustion means supplying proper oxygen for the combustion. If 1 kg of fuel need 1 kg of oxygen, we have to supply 1 kg of oxygen. That one we call complete combustion. For example, carbon plus oxygen gives carbon dioxide, that is CO2. For same element, carbon, incomplete combustion giving insufficient oxygen, which means 0.5 oxygen only we are giving, it coming as CO, that is carbon monoxide. So what is the drawback of this one? If you see, during CO2, that is complete combustion, it liberates 8080 kilocol of heat, whereas incomplete combustion is liberate only 2430 kilocals. So loss of heat energy. That's why we always aim for complete combustion. Now we will discuss the combustion elements that are available. Carbon from fuel, hydrogen from fuel, sulfur from fuel, oxygen from air, because air contains oxygen and nitrogen. So from air only the oxygen will participate in the combustion. Now we will discuss the oxidation of carbon, hydrogen and sulfur. First one, oxidation of carbon, which means carbon plus oxygen gives carbon dioxide. For example, the atomic weight, atomic mass for carbon is 12, that we know. Similarly, the atomic weight or mass for oxygen is 16. 16 here we have 2, so it's a 32. Both carbon and oxygen gives carbon dioxide in complete combustion. So C is 12, it is 32, 44 CO2, which means 12 kg of carbon needed 32 kg of oxygen for complete combustion, which produce 44 kg of carbon dioxide. Now for 1 kg of carbon, how much is needed? So what we have to do, we have to reduce 12 times. So 32 divided by 12, 44 divided by 12, which means 1 kg of carbon needed 8 by 3 kg of oxygen, and which produce 11 by 3 kg of CO2. Oxygen is required, CO2 is produced. So how much oxygen is required for the carbon? Here 1 kg we know 8 by 3, if it is 0.5 kg means 8 by 3 into 0.5 we can multiply. So from this equation, the amount of oxygen is required we can find out for carbon alone. Similarly, how much it produces, the combustion products, that is equal to 11 by 3 into percentage of carbon. So from this equation, we can find out the combustion products that comes from the carbon alone when there is the complete combustion. Remember, during combustion, 1 kg of carbon release 8080 kilocal of heat in a complete combustion. Then to find out the heat liberated or heat release, that is calorific value, equal to 8080 into percentage of carbon which is available in the fuel. From these three relation, we can find out oxygen is required, combustion products coming out from the fuel, as well as how much heat it liberates. The next one, oxidation of hydrogen. We know that hydrogen is H2. Hydrogen, the atomic weight is 1, so 2, we have 2, plus oxygen, the atomic weight is 16, 2, 32 divided by 2, because it is supplying only insufficient oxygen, which gives H2O, water. 2 kg of hydrogen required 16 kg of oxygen. O2 is 32 divided by 2 is 16. Both will produce 18 kg of water. Then 1 kg of hydrogen required 16 divided by 2 kg of oxygen, and it will produce 18 by 2 kg of water, which means 1 kg of hydrogen required 8 kg of oxygen, remember, and it produce 9 kg of water. Now it's easy to find out the oxygen required for hydrogen, that is 8 into percentage of hydrogen. Similarly, the combustion products, that is 9 into percentage of hydrogen. Remember, 1 kg of hydrogen releases 34,500 kcal of heat. Then, if you need to find out the amount of heat liberated or released, Cv is equal to 34,500 into percentage of hydrogen. From these three relations, we can find out the amount of oxygen required to burn hydrogen. The combustion product is coming from the hydrogen and how much heat is liberated due to hydrogen. The next one, oxidation of sulfur. Sulfur, we know that is 32 atomic weight. React with oxygen, that is O2, gives sulfuric dioxide, that is SO2. S is 12 atomic weight. Oxygen is 16 into 2, 32, which produce 64 kg of SO2, which means 32 kg of sulfur required 32 kg of oxygen, which produce 64 kg of SO2. Then 1 kg of sulfur needed 32 divided by 32, 64 divided by 32. So 1 kg of sulfur required 1 kg of oxygen, which produce 2 kg of sulfuric dioxide, that is SO2. Now it's easy to find out the oxygen required to burn the sulfur, that is 1 into percentage of sulfur in the fuel. The combustion products 2 into percentage of sulfur in the fuel. 1 kg of sulfur liberate 2240 kcal of heat. Now it's easy to find out the heat liberated or release rate, that is 2240 into percentage of sulfur. From these three relations, we can find out the oxygen required, combustion products, as well as heat release rate for the sulfur. Now, we will discuss the minimum oxygen required for combustion. As we discussed earlier, only carbon, hydrogen and sulfur will participate in the combustion. So, oxygen required for carbon, 8 by 3 into percentage of carbon. For hydrogen, 8 into percentage of hydrogen. For sulfur, 1 into percentage of sulfur. If we add all these, we will get the minimum oxygen required for the combustion. That is O2 is equal to 8 by 3 into percentage of carbon plus 8 into percentage of hydrogen plus 1 into percentage of sulfur. Remember, the fuel itself contains some amount of oxygen. That is very, very important. Then for that case, we have to remember that oxygen percentage. So this equation is rewritten like this, minus the percentage of oxygen in the fuel. This is generalized equation to find out the minimum oxygen is required for the combustion. In many textbooks, they form like this. This 8 by 3 into percentage of carbon, this 8 by 3 into percentage of carbon same. This 8 we have taken commonly. Percentage of hydrogen, this O2 we have taken inside, minus percentage of O2 divided by 8. This 8 will get cancelled. We have only percentage of O2 plus the percentage of sulfur. Many textbooks they have written like this, or we can use only this format also. It's not an issue. Now we will discuss the minimum air required for the combustion, because only atmospheric air contains the oxygen. We know that the composition in terms of mass, 23% of oxygen and 77% of nitrogen. So this is our oxygen required, the minimum oxygen required for the combustion divided by 0.23 will give the minimum air required for the combustion. Now we will discuss gross or higher calorific value. We know that heat release rate in the carbon 8080 into percentage of carbon. In hydrogen, 34,500 into percent of hydrogen. In sulfur, 2,240 into percent of sulfur. By adding all these, we can get the higher or gross calorific value. Remember, fuel itself contains some amount of oxygen. So we have to rewrite the equation as we did in previous equation. That is 8080 into percent of carbon plus 34,500 into percentage of hydrogen minus O2 divided by 8 plus 2240 into percent of sulfur. First, we have to understand what is meant by hygrographic value. Hygrographic value means we are taking all the heat in the combustion. For example, moisture which is not participated in the combustion, ash which is not participated in the combustion. But both moisture and ash will absorb heat from the combustion. So those heat also we are considering because we are condensing and we are reusing. By assuming like that, we are calculating the higher calorific value. Lower calorific value means we are neglecting those heat, which means that is higher calorific value minus this 2466 is the heat having in the moisture, and we know it produced 9 kg of water, that is a 9 into percentage of hydrogen. So this is the difference between higher calorific value and lower calorific value. Once again, I tell you, higher calorific value will consider all the heat in the combustion, but lower calorific value will not consider the heat which absorbs in the combustion and escapes to the atmosphere. In next lecture, we will discuss few problems on boiler indirect method. Thank you.